Hey people, welcome to the last episode of Rough Vocal Effects Revisited. In the previous two episodes, I updated my pedagogy of false fault distortion and fry scream. These are also some of the main topics my teaching has been focused on, so it makes sense that my understanding of them has changed the most within the last 3 years. But I've also accumulated some specific points about other rough vocal effects that I want to bring on, even if they don't suffice for a 20-minute video on their own. So my suggestion is we just walk through the original Rough Vocal Effects 101 series chronologically and supplement everything that I haven't touched upon yet. At the end of this video, we're going to take a brief look at some of the free resources about rough vocal effects that you can find on my website, so stay tuned. Episode 4 of Rough Vocal Effects 101 deals with rattles, squalls and growls, all of which I have introduced to be arytenoid-based effects.
Ah! Ah!
The arytenoid cartilages are two bumps at the back of the larynx that are mainly responsible for closing and opening the vocal folds, but at the top of the arytenoids there are some small extra bumps, namely the corniculate cartilages and the cuneiform cartilages, and those are actually the parts that vibrate against each other when I speak of arytenoid phonation. You can see it quite well in this endoscopy of my own larynx. And you can hear quite well that my vocal folds are enclosing completely, even though you don't see them because my epiglottis obscures the view. By the way, the narrowing of my pharynx that is responsible for the squished shaping of my epiglottis is twang, and while the sound of it might not be particularly endearing, this video example of rattle and breathy falsetto proves a couple of things. Number one, you can twang without necessarily closing the vocal folds. Number two, the top parts of the arytenoids can vibrate against each other without closing the vocal folds. Number three, the low rolly sound that you hear in the effect I call rattle is actually being produced by the vibration of those cartilages, not the false folds. The reason I mention these things is that often you'll hear people equate twang with closure, which is not the case. Twang is twang and closure is closure. Twang might help maintaining or increasing the closure, and it can even help bringing the false folds together on top of the true folds, and it's therefore an important didactic tool, but just because it's intuitive doesn't mean it's the only way. Also, some people have had doubts that an unvoiced rattle sound is actually being achieved by the cartilages vibrating, and lots of other screaming coaches will falsely attribute this sound to the false folds. You might argue that because of the squished epiglottis in my endoscopy, you can't actually see whether the false folds are contributing to that sound. So here's a video from the CVT research site that shows quite clearly that the false folds are not touching during the sound of rattle. Complete Vocal Technique also mentions the possibility of uvular rattle, so the uvula, which, to quote Cardi B, is that little dangly thing that swing in the back of my throat, vibrating against the tongue. In the German language, that's one way of articulating the R consonant, like this, R. But you could also imitate the sound of a retinoid rattle, like this, ah, or make monster noises like this one, which is of great use for voice acting in movies and video games. There is actually another way to make a similar sound, as my friend and colleague Gregory West has found out. Namely, the epiglottis vibrating against the pharynx.
That's crazy.
This effect needs a lot more airflow and tends to go even lower than usual rattle. Here's my demonstration of a arytenoid vibration versus epiglottic vibration. Do not mistake the latter for blues growl though. This one is often described as epiglottic vibration too, but as you can see in this scope of me doing the effect, the epiglottis is being pushed down by the tongue root towards the arytenoids and doesn't touch the pharynx. Here's another video from the CVT research site where you can see the cuneiform cartilages, so the top of the arytenoids, vibrating against the epiglottis. Yeah. For this reason, I still define blues growl as an area-biglottic effect, regardless of whether the area-biglottic faults actually contribute to the sound or not. According to this CVT study, about a third of the participants showed some actual vibration of the area-biglottic faults. However, I think that this thing I wrote about the area-biglottic faults vibrating against each other is bullshit. Unless maybe you have very special anatomy, even though some other research papers seem to imply that it's possible. One last thing concerning episode 4. I mentioned the possibility of hypercompressed growl.
Oh yeah!
But not hypercompressed rattle. The reason for that is simple. I can't do it, and I've never seen anyone else do it. If you can do it and have endoscopic evidence of the sound being produced by the arytenoid cartilages, feel free to send it to me. Maybe at some point we could differentiate twangy rattle, pushed rattle, and hypercompressed rattle, like I already do with distortion. Now let's summarize what we've talked about so far. We have 5 main kinds of supraglottal vocal effects, or kinds of tissues above the vocal folds that we can vibrate. False fault distortion, A! Arytenoid rattle, A! Epiglottic rattle, A! Uvular rattle, A! And area-biglottic growl, A! Theoretically, you could also add saliva rattle to the list, because with a bit of luck, an extra production of spit could resemble the sound of a retinoid rattle quite well, but as this one isn't reliably accessible, I'm not gonna include it in this list. Still, here's a fun example of me playing around with saliva rattle after a nice meal. Episode 5 of Rough Vocal Effects 101 dealt with false chord scream, or as I used to synonymously call it, death growl or grunt. By grunt, I'm now referring to only the truefold part of it. Back then, I already suspected that you could do a truefold dominant false chord scream, and I've managed to get some footage with my endoscope of a less intense grunt that almost resembles false fault distortion or throat singing. But meanwhile, I've also discovered footage of the truefaults making for almost a full death growl sound already. Adding the false faults and arytenoids tends to make it even more brutal, and those are also what we typically see when experienced vocalists like Brandon Kennedy demonstrate their false chord. So nowadays I tend to define false chord scream as an effect combination consisting out of grunt, distortion, and rattle. But of course any other combination of these sounds is still possible and allows for great variation within the technique. Depending on which effect you start with, you could have more grunty false chords, more distorted false chords, and more rattly false chords. These 3 kinds of false chord correspond quite well to specific exercises that you might have come across so far. For example, the grunty one often works well through imitating the sound of an annoyed sigh, or dog barking. The more distorted one is basically the false chord from Cargira approach. And the rattly one you can find by imitating Batman.
I am Batman.
Or breathing heavily. Those different approaches also tend to lead to different amounts of airflow. So with the grunty false chord. Your air will be gone relatively quickly, but not as quickly as with a very breathy, rattly false chord. If you want to sustain your false chord for as long as possible, I'd recommend the more distorted version, specifically a relatively quiet low scream. But even that one can't be sustained as long as any kind of fry scream. Here's a little triangle of false chord scream for you. I really like fancy diagrams, as you've probably noticed by now. We could identify 4 points on this triangle, namely the more grunty false chord, the more distorted one, the more rattly one, and the common false chord scream, which is a nice mixture of all effects. Of course, many more in-betweens are possible, but probably it's most practical to limit it to these four main kinds of false chord scream. Also, you could learn to control the amount of pitch in your grunt, and possibly do pitched false chords.
Oh! Oh! Oh!
And the range and volume you start your grunt from can determine whether your false chord sounds more chesty or heady.
Ooh! Oh!
Of course, what I said about pitch perception in atonal false chords is still true. The darker the sound color, so the lower your larynx, the more compressed the tongue, and the smaller the mouth opening, the lower your scream will sound. And vice versa, the brighter the sound color, so the higher your larynx, the broader the tongue, and the wider the mouth opening, the higher your scream will sound. That way you can get the whole spectrum of lows, mids, and highs in the same underlying technique, like this. And of course, the same applies to all other screaming techniques, as I've demonstrated in the previous episode of this series already. One more thing, back in 2020 I didn't really know what a tunnel throat was. Again, I'm playing around with different grades of lip rounding here to get this kind of tunnel throat scream. Or rather, I thought I knew what it was, but actually I had it mixed up with what most people would call a guttural. This is a guttural. And as you can see, my tongue tip is reaching up against my heart palate, resulting in a very low sound, even if I speak with it. And if I apply that shape to my false chord, also of course changing my mouth shape, I get variations of lows from it. If my tongue tip is still touching the heart palate but very fronted, I get a pig squeal. So, gutturals and pig squeals are on a continuum, and just depending on how bright or dark exactly it is, we start perceiving it as two different techniques. However, with tunnel throats, we actually have a different tongue technique. You can see that my tongue tip is touching my bottom teeth, which doesn't sound as dark as this guttural shape. Even if I round my mouth on a tunnel scream, I can never sound as dark as just your regular guttural. But with the tunnel throat, you can get what some people call polyphonic screams, where it sounds like there's two different melodies going in opposite directions. Of course, we're not talking about true full pitch, but we're talking about resonances. And those resonances, if we're not used to hearing them from normal vowels that we have in everyday speech, they sound kind of alien-like, inhumane, or polyphonic. Another possibility I haven't mentioned so far is adding nasality to your false chord, either in its pure form by keeping the mouth closed, like this, or by nasalizing the vowels. As opposed to keeping them completely oral with the nasal port closed.
Ah, oh.
One way you can check for nasality is by plugging and unplugging your nose with your fingers while screaming. If the sound changes like this, it's nasal. If it doesn't, it's not. So that concludes our summary of false chord scream. In the sixth episode of Rough Vocal Effects 101, I introduced three kinds of polyphonic splitting, so true fault-based effects that are neither atonal, like irregular creaking, nor produce stable subharmonics, like regular creaking. The anatomical differences between creaking and splitting haven't been researched on a lot yet, but one theory is that, while creaking is a complex vibratory pattern of the vocal folds, splitting is the result of a left-to-right asymmetry of the vocal fold vibration. The three categories I came up with in 2020 are air splitting, fry splitting, and hypercompressed splitting. My fascination for this group of effects has been growing deeper and deeper since, and I've recorded tons of little splitting demos that I could analyze in a spectrogram. For example, with this air splitting sound.
Ooh, yeah!
You can see several fundamentals that are in no subharmonic relationship to each other. The same is true for these fry splitting examples. Especially in the last one, you can see two completely independent pitches. One of the coolest clips that I might have ever recorded, though, is this example of hypercompressed splitting, where my split starts on a major third and then goes up exactly one octave, while my other twofold pitch consistently stays on this kind of pedal tone, if you will. I've also managed to scope myself on all of these sounds, and what I found supports my way of naming them. Air splitting uses an extra amount of air, as you can see from the additional opening that appears at the back of the vocal folds. Fry splitting has a perfect closure of the vocal folds that resembles the laryngeal gesture of creaking. And hypercompressed splitting has the typical false fold constriction of the Valsalva maneuver that we have in other hypercompressed techniques too, but with a little opening of the back of the fold, similar to the one you see in air splitting. So far, I've stumbled upon two new kinds of splitting. The first one is very similar to grunt in terms of its airflow and shaping, but much quieter and very limited in range. The second one is actually this sound that I could already do back in 2020, but at that time didn't understand yet. It sounded a bit like rattle, but it didn't feel like the arytenoid cartilages, and I couldn't isolate it, so I already suspected that it was vocal fold based, but I couldn't be sure until I bought my own endoscope. I managed to briefly scope myself on this sound too, and as you can see, no supraglottal tissues are vibrating, only the true vocal folds are producing a very breathy sound with this bubbly rolling noise in it. For lack of a better term, I'm just gonna call it bubble splitting. Judging from the huge gap between the vocal folds, as well as my sensation, bubble splitting requires the highest amount of airflow out of all splitting techniques, and we could actually make another fancy diagram out of that. How about the continuum of splitting? Or even better, now that we've talked about all exhaled rough vocal effects, we could make an airflow continuum out of that. And since we're almost at the end of this video, allow me to get even a bit crazier. Let's add inhale screaming and inhale splitting to the continuum.
Yow! Yow! Row! Row!
Technically, they have negative airflow, and even though I had some doubts about it in 2020, it turns out that ingressive phonation is completely sustainable if done right. And actually, it's even being used in voice therapy to establish more efficient phonation. Now that is a nice diagram to conclude the series with. I recommend checking out the free material branch on my website tony-lenke.com, where you can find all the slides and diagrams of this series, as well as even more content in rough vocal effects, like for example this PDF with practical cues for finding distortion, endoscopy videos, sound examples of all effects in real music, spectrogram screenshots from the overtone analyzer, and much more. You can find the link to my website in the video description. I've also put the link to my PayPal there, in case you want to buy me a tea. That's it! That was our Rough Vocal Effects Revisited series. I hope you had some fun and maybe even learned something, but even if you haven't, thanks for sticking around, I guess. See you soon!